Not everybody gets to see this. Feel privileged. So this is the heat treat process. We're trying to instill chemical properties into the steel so that it does what it's designed to do. This round is designed to kill people. We want to make sure that when it hits the ground and explodes, that it breaks up into little tiny parts, and those parts kill people. That's what we do. We build things to kill people.
The latest on the war in Ukraine. The U.S. is doubling down on military aid to Ukraine.
200,000 pounds of lethal American military aid arrived in Ukraine overnight.
The package includes heavy artillery,
two multiple launch rocket systems, 200 missiles, and 50 armored personnel carriers.
Military vehicles and ammunition for American-made HIMARS.
Striker vehicles, Bradley vehicles, a lot of munitions.
Puma drones, counter-artillery radars, and up to six additional National Advanced Surface-to-Air missile systems, like the ones used to protect the skies of Washington.
We've invested well north of $30 billion in this endeavor,
which is about three times the largest year of support for the Afghan security forces during that war. It's extraordinary. It's an enormous sum.
And it's been growing since. And yet, it hasn't managed to deal a decisive blow yet. 1 year in, the war between Russia and Ukraine is deadlocked in a stalemate.
Both sides are going to try and deliver a knockout punch over the next 6 to 8 months. Neither of them starts in a dominant position. I think Russia is going to have the advantage of more troops, and Ukraine will have basically every other advantage: equipment, training, allies, morale.
But one distinct advantage they don't currently have is also the one they arguably need the most.
Нам нужны і далі більше снарядів. Ми всю цю війну ми на артилерійській такій на снарядній дієті. Не сказати, що зовсім голод, але дієта.
The war in Ukraine is consuming an enormous amount of ammunition and depleting allied stockpiles. Orders placed today would only be delivered 2.5 years later.
I mean, it is kind of remarkable that a lot of this is coming down to the supply of artillery shells, because they are just being shot at a rate that is almost unimaginable.
The Ukrainians are firing as much in a month as the United States used to produce in a year.
And scaling up will also take a while. The Pentagon currently plans to increase artillery production sixfold in 2 years.
It does take time.
If quick ramp up is part of your strategy, you need to make sure that you can do it. Ukraine is a very rude awakening to the defense industry.
We have multiple threats around the globe here for which we need to prepare. And I am concerned that when you take that in totality, we're not moving quickly enough.
І знаєте, коли на совєтських полігонах був такий лозунг у артилеристів: каждый снаряд в цель. Вот нас жизнь заставляет его воплощать в реальность.
155-millimeter howitzer shells have become an unlikely cornerstone of the Russia-Ukraine war, as the grinding stalemate turned the conflict into World War I-like trench warfare.
Whenever armies reach a stalemate, that is, they're not maneuvering very much, then firepower becomes much more important.
First, because tanks and infantry become way less useful as they turn into vulnerable targets, an easy prey to artillery fire. But what about some of the more advanced weapon systems, like
F-16? Он універсален, уже много не лет, даже десятилетий доказал свою функциональность, свою эффективность. И если бы у нас был этот комплект, мы могли бы более существенно закрыть свое небо.
We have considered that request. And the honest truth is, the cost of trying to get the F-16 up and ready to operate in Ukraine, even if we basically said there's nothing more important, best case scenario, we could maybe get some operational F-16s into Ukraine within a year, maybe 8 months if we really pushed it. And this is getting lucky, all right? Because you don't just have to train the pilots. You have to train the mechanics, you have to have airfields that can accommodate the F-16, and you have to have the spare parts to make it work. So we looked at that and we determined that is not a wise use of the resources that are necessary to win the fight.
Unlike artillery ammunition, In fact, military experts claim that ammunition availability might be the single most important factor that determines the course of war this year. In the age of drones and AI, what's deciding the fate on the battlefield is these unwieldy, unguided, explosive hunks of steel, which are now in short supply.
Early on, with respect to munitions, but also other types of equipment, there were some demand side issues. We weren't really sure whether the Ukrainians were going to last.
Almost every military assessment said that the Russians would take over Ukraine in a matter of days. And so we didn't want a whole bunch of American weapons just falling into Russian hands.
But now that it's clear that Ukrainians have put up this amazing fight, now it's less of a demand side issue and I think more of a supply side issue.
First, it's worth looking at what the US has already provided, or at least pledged to Ukraine.
The United States has funded about $115 billion worth of aid. And now not all of that has yet been spent. That will take aid program probably to midsummer. And about 40% of that, maybe $50 billion, is military aid to Ukraine. About $18 billion is support for U.S. forces. And the rest is divided between humanitarian assistance, economic assistance to the Ukrainian government.
To date, the administration has distributed over $75 billion of that money, including $46 billion in security assistance.
And out of that more tangible piece of the pie,
the United States at least committed 1.5 million 155-millimeter projectiles. Those cost, on average, about $2,000 a piece, so that would come out to be about $3 billion worth of projectiles.
And while 1.5 million sounds like a lot of ammo, well, it isn't really, if you ask the Ukrainians.
За сутки в середньому враг использует в снарядном измерении на нашем участке фронта, не только Бахмут, тут еще один из участок Купянско-Лиманский, где-то 30 тысяч снарядов. То есть это один участок фронта. Вот посчитайте, у нас где-то 4 таких направления.
It would be nice to have 90,000 or 100,000 per month to be ready to deter enemies and be ready to go with the counteroffensive campaign.
And that's nowhere near current rates of production.
We're producing about 14,000 shells every month, and they're using 6,000 to 7,000 a day.
The United States is trying to get that up to 24,000 rounds a month by the end of this year, and then as many as 80 or 90,000 a month.
So this mismatch in current rates explains why the stockpiles have been running low. But why does it take so long to ramp up production?
So Kraglin needed low-tech, explosive-filled bullets.
Well, there's two answers to this for why it takes so long. The first is that we've been on a peacetime footing for a long time.
I don't think we ever expected to be in a months-long artillery duel with trench warfare.
Никто не думал, что после Второй мировой войны снаряды нужны будут в таком же количестве.
We've downsized our ammunition factories.
From 86 plants by the end of the Second World War to just 5 today, as the number of the defense prime contractors shrank tenfold, which means far fewer links in the brittle supply chains.
It's really since the end of the Cold War that industries have consolidated to a very great extent.
Department of Defense told defense industry that they were going to have to get smaller.
We're not going to have the same level of demand that we had before. We need to be managing our inventories, managing our production processes in a way that is lean.
One way to do it, get rid of your well-stocked inventories and rely on the so-called just-in-time deliveries of specific parts instead, which is exactly what the defense industry did in an effort to cut costs.
And it's consistent with what, you know, business has been trying to do also. It's really based on a kind of fallacious assumption, however, because what works for FedEx in peacetime is not necessarily going to work for the nation in wartime.
So even though it takes just a few days to actually produce these artillery shells, waiting for the right parts can take up weeks or even months.
So that's the first reason. While there's a good excuse in reason one for why it's taking a long time to ramp up, reason two is that we're just honestly not trying as hard as we could.
Because while virtually everyone agrees on the need to ramp up, the Pentagon and the industry don't see eye to eye on how that's supposed to happen. And to really grasp that point, consider the ventilators.
Beginning of the COVID crisis, there's this huge spike in ventilator requirement. Then we went and got factories opened, and of course did all that. Hundreds of ventilators were produced.
And then came the vaccines. So no one really needed those ventilators anymore.
And now there's a huge excess of ventilators. If excess capacity is maintained for a contingency, somebody's gonna pay for it, and that's probably not gonna be the industry. It's unrealistic to expect the industry to do that.
Which is why the defense industry has been clamoring for those multi-year contracts before ramping up, to ensure they're not left footing the bill if the war is over tomorrow.
Well, I think the industry is always going to press for more. That's kind of, in a way, their job to their shareholders and so forth. But they shouldn't be the tail that wags the dog. I mean, they shouldn't be determining policy.
The Pentagon, symbol of big government made necessary in a complex world.
The Pentagon, for its part, has its own balance to strike between ensuring that the industry can scale up when needed and being a good steward of the taxpayer dollars.
So building new factories, making it easier to ship weapons out the door without regulation, multi-year contracts that lend themselves to cost overruns, possible cost gouging by contractors. There's a lot of problems with just assuming that Ukraine means a permanent increase in the Pentagon budget.
The Pentagon budget is already huge. The request for the coming fiscal year is at whopping $842 billion.
Which is one of the highest levels since World War II, much higher than Vietnam or Korea or the height of the Cold War. Aid to Ukraine, even if it, you know, at $30 billion a year, is a relatively small percentage.
And besides, as the Pentagon learned the hard way with Ukraine, simply throwing money at the industry won't magically solve their problems overnight. In some way, the current shortages of ammo stem from the same root cause as the shortages of ventilators and PPE and COVID tests at the onset of the pandemic. It's what happens when private companies take over government industries and run them like a business. They innovate, modernize, and run things smoothly when it's business as usual. But when a crisis hits, the simple truth is public interest and profits don't always align.
My concern is not just that Ukraine will get what it needs in time. I think we have a path to get there, but that we will also be prepared for this terrible potential eventuality in the Pacific.
God forbid, if we were to go to war with China, we would use up most of the preferred munitions very quickly. Depends on who you talk to about how quickly, but let's just say 8 days, 2 weeks, something like that.
Well, there are a number of things we have to do. For example, there's a provision in this year's defense bill to do co-production of weapons in Taiwan.
Europe is trying something similar with Ukraine at the moment. 18 countries recently sealed a 1 billion euros deal to jointly procure the 155mm shells from European industry under a plan
to send to Ukraine 1 million rounds of 155 caliber ammunition. Definitely, there are many, many details still to solve.
It's a bit challenging because if you start talking about the incentives that we were just discussing, creating incentives among different governments can be a bit of a process.
It's always going to be a challenge with every conflict relying on a certain type of defense equipment and trying to pivot as quickly as we can. There's never going to be a great answer for how to do that.
But part of that answer involves keeping an end goal in mind. It's easy to lose sight of it in the fog of war or in the heat of an arms race, when tensions run high and the stakes are life and death.
We build things to kill people.
But it's also what makes it so crucial. Because for every war, that ultimate end goal is peace.
Negotiated settlement. I don't think that's in the cards now. Putin doesn't seem to be highly interested, nor do the Ukrainian leadership, but it should be part of the calculation, not just pouring in weapons and hoping it all works out.
Especially since, as time goes on, casualties mount, and the support for Ukraine aid softens in the U.S.
How many more times do you think Congress needs to provide aid?
No more blank checks for Ukraine.
So first of all, if you go into a classified room of the Armed Services Committee, there is complete bipartisan support for Ukraine. But I hear from my Republican colleagues that the influence of the few on the far right is is having an effect.
То, що нам партнери дали орудия 155-го калибра і дали снаряди к ним, это очень нас выручило, потому что мы вели очень кровопролитную, очень жестокую борьбу с противником, который преобладал во всем над нами, в том числе в количестве артиллерии. Мы не очень ценим эту помощь, но поверьте, это не просто безвозмездная помощь, а это, по сути, инвестиция в будущий безопасный мир.
And at the end of the day, what we all want is peace. Through all the back and forth of this conflict over many brutal months at this point, let's not lose sight of the fact that there's one simple way that this war could end this afternoon, and that's for Russia to pull out of Ukraine. That's ultimately what we want.
Then the inspectors take over. Here is a modern...